Hello, I'm John Craig, Division Chief of Rhinology at Henry Ford Health System in Detroit, Michigan. I'm going to talk today about odontogenic sinusitis, what it is, why it's possible you've never heard of it, and some of the research I've been doing. Okay, so first we're going to look at a coronal bone window CT scan. I'm going to direct your attention to the left side of the screen, which is actually the patient's right maxillary sinus. You'll notice it's black, which is normal on a CT scan as it represents air, which is normally in the sinuses. Below this sinus is something that looks like a tooth. That's because it is a tooth. Everyone has teeth sitting right below their maxillary sinuses, usually the molars or premolars. Now I'm going to direct your attention to the left maxillary sinus, which in this case is completely filled with gray, which is not normal. This gray also extends into a neighboring anterior ethmoid sinus. Gray on a CT scan can be swollen tissue, mucus, or pus, and in this case is most likely due to the molar on this side, which if you compare to the other side, looks a little different. That's because around the tooth root apices, they have something called periapical lesions, or in this case, likely an abscess on both of the tooth roots. This is causing raising, thinning, and erosion of the bone, and this allows infection to spread from the tooth root into the sinus, leading to odontogenic sinusitis. And that's what we're going to talk about for the next few minutes. So how do infections from the teeth actually get to the sinus? I think it's first helpful to look at a diagram of a tooth. So here we see a maxillary molar. This is what we would call the occlusal surface where you chew. On the inside, you have the tooth pulp where blood vessels and nerves run. And then we have these areas called the tooth root apices or the tooth root apex. Above that is where the maxillary sinus is. Then around the tooth, we have bone called the alveolar bone. We have gingiva or the gum line. And then this space here called the periodontal ligament. And the ligament is what holds teeth in position and seated down into the bone. Okay, so with that in mind, there are four general causes of odontogenic sinusitis. First we'll talk about is periodontitis, referring to inflammation or infection in the gum line, the bone, or the periodontal ligament space. And that can allow spread through the bone and into the maxillary sinus. There are also endodontic causes, such as pulpitis or pulp necrosis, where there's an infection or inflammation in the tooth pulp. This thing can spread to the apex of the tooth or outside the apex and cause a periapical lesion. This is either a cyst, granuloma, or abscess, and it starts as a reaction to the pulp. One other very common type is an oroantral fistula, or a direct communication between the oral cavity and the maxillary sinus. These can be temporary after a dental extraction or a sinus lift procedure, or they can be permanent if they do not heal. Lastly, you can have a dental foreign body, such as a dislodged tooth root after extraction, a dental implant, or even extruded root canal material going directly into the sinus. So here are some CT representations of the typical types of odontogenic pathology. We'll start with this image here. It's a sagittal CT scan. You see a tooth here with some kind of filling material and a periapical lesion with raised thin bone and adjacent maxillary sinus opacification. Next, another periapical lesion and the arrows pointing at the lesion with two periapical lesions or abscesses with adjacent sinusitis. Here is an oroantral fistula after prior dental extraction, again with an opening here allowing a communication between the oral cavity to the sinus, leading to a maxillary and ethmoid odontogenic sinusitis. And lastly, we have here a foreign body in the sinus after a dental extraction, so that's part of a tooth root, and it's leading to sinus mucosal thickening. And this patient was symptomatic, so it was consistent with odontogenic sinusitis. So this large meta-analysis in 2014 looked at 674 patients and found that extraction-related oroantral fistula was the most common cause of 65%, periapical lesions 25%, periodontitis 8%, and others like foreign bodies 2%. One of the reasons many are not aware of odontogenic sinusitis is that it's underrepresented in our literature. Longini and Ferguson reviewed 85 sinusitis practice guidelines published from 1998 to 2010. Only 11 of those mentioned odontogenic pathology as a cause for maxillary sinusitis. Only 3 of those outlined diagnostic protocols for the condition, and none discussed management. The 2015 updated adult sinusitis clinical practice guidelines did not mention odontogenic sinusitis diagnosis or management. And the more recent 2016 rhinosinusitis consensus statement dedicated less than 1 page of a 200-page document to odontogenic sinusitis. It's also not discussed in the differential diagnosis in the unilateral sinus disease literature, and it's not present in the ABOTA rhinology curriculum for resident education. Regarding treatment, previous studies have shown that dental treatment may be successful alone, often requiring sinus surgery as well, though. However, this is not evidence that dental treatment must precede sinus surgery. So, rather than considering whether dental treatment or sinus surgery is more likely to cure the condition ultimately, we could instead think of which treatment leads to faster disease resolution, and that one could be performed first. This led me to do a 3-year prospective cohort study of 37 patients with symptomatic odontogenic sinusitis. 26 of these patients underwent primary endoscopic sinus surgery. They were followed for a mean of 144 days, so nearly 5 months, and this was until their last follow-up or until they received dental treatment. 11 of the patients chose to undergo primary dental treatment, which entailed a root canal or dental extraction. They were followed for a mean of 77 days until either their last follow-up or until they failed and wished to undergo sinus surgery. The following prospective data were collected: pre- and post-operative symptoms, pre- and post-operative SNOT-22 quality of life scores, pre- and post-operative endoscopy, including middle meatal edema, polyps, or pus, and then pre-operative CT sinus imaging to grade the patient's disease extent. So here is the breakdown of patients' odontogenic pathology. So you see relatively equal amounts of periapical lesions and temporary oroarantral fistula. And then when we graded patients' disease extents based on CT scans, but also preoperative symptoms, there were no significant differences between the patients undergoing primary dental treatment and sinus surgery. And here's what we found. So first, we looked at the resolution of symptoms and endoscopy findings by the time of their last follow-up, which in the sinus surgery group was approximately 5 months, and in the dental treatment group was approximately 77 days. So what you see here is that in the sinus surgery group, the improvement in all the symptoms and nearly all the endoscopy findings were statistically significant, whereas in the dental treatment group, you see that only 2 of the symptoms significantly improve with dental treatment alone, whereas the rest of the improvements were not significant. Then if we compared dental treatment to sinus surgery here, and we looked at the difference between pre- and post-operative presence of symptoms and endoscopy findings, again, there was a statistically significant improvement in the sinus surgery group compared to the dental treatment group across nearly all symptoms and endoscopy findings. And here's the really cool part. We did a Kaplan-Meier analysis to assess the time to resolution of different symptoms represented here, SNOT-22 quality of life improvement of greater than or equal to 9 points, or endoscopy findings. Now these are just 4 of the variables assessed, but all the symptoms, endoscopy findings, and SNOT-22 scores were assessed. And what we found is represented in this table. You can see very clearly that the time to resolution in the sinus surgery group was significantly shorter than the time to resolution in the dental treatment group, somewhere between 7 to 12 days versus 35 to nearly 60 days in the dental treatment group. And this was true for essentially all symptoms, endoscopy scores, and the improvement in their quality of life scores. And you can see this here with their statistical significance being less than 0.05 and very high hazard ratios. So what does this mean? Well, for symptomatic odontogenic sinusitis, sinus surgery results in significantly faster and more complete resolution of nearly all symptoms, quality of life detriments, and endoscopic findings. This is not to say that patients still need close dental follow-up and possibly treatment. And to end, this is just a quick plug for the upcoming Odontogenic Sinusitis Multidisciplinary Panel. It will be moderated by myself Friday, September 13th, 3:30 to 4:10 p.m. at the National ARS meeting. We have a great group of panelists from the endodontic side. We have Roderick Tatarin, oral surgeon, Tara Agalu, and then multiple rhinologists, Al Picorni, David Petker, Stacy Gray, and Jose Matos, all whom have been publishing on this important condition. Thank you very much.